maybe I can, because I can appreciate how some viewers, and you talked about folk in the clergy, who may perceive the issue because of liquor being involved as one that may not be worthy of our coming together with the issue, but I kind of see it from another vantage point. I can imagine taking some guests who come to visit me out in Peoria and being turned away. And see, for those of us who experience racism, we don't need it adjudicated in a hearing, in a courtroom setting, because we're familiar with it. We know it when it comes at us. We see it in your eyes. We see it when your throat starts turning red when you're talking to it. We know all of the signs. Mm-hmm. My history has been that kind of scenario may evoke a violent act. And we haven't got to that point yet. And I'm suggesting is I think it may be a little more serious than we appreciate, because certain people are not accustomed to being abused racially, may act out. There may not be the police officer who's an undercover person who's trained and who's there on an expedition, but certain persons, when you violate their civil rights, they feel provoked and they react to it. And I think that we're lucky that that hasn't occurred, but I think kind of condoning it sets the environment for that kind of conflict in our streets in Peoria.
Well, when I first filed my complaints against the Peoria Marquette, I received a number of phone calls from individuals who had similar kinds of problems. The unfortunate part for most of them, violence in some senses did occur, but they were the ones who were arrested and taken to jail,
right,
because they were discriminated against. Now, I don't know whether indeed they were or not, but I'm willing to bet that the treatment I received was the same kind of treatment. But because they indeed did act out, they then become the double victim. So not only are they discriminated against, but the system and the institution itself allows them to be seen as the perpetrator of the crime. They then are arrested, they have a record, or they have to pay a fine, simply because discrimination exists.
Are we in a position in Peoria where the black community feels it can afford to take actions against large institutions that discriminate the way we did in the 60s? Or does the economic environment render the black community impotent? Yeah, that's a good one.
I don't. And here again, I just think that those of us in position of leadership need to remind this community that we're not going to tolerate it. And I have a feeling that we may have contributed to this climate by not aggressively saying some things. Because as I indicated earlier, this situation first developed with rumors. I went to really to see what was going to transpire that night, because I had turned it all over to Miss Jackson. I just assumed that the thing was in hand, and we had a good counsel, we had good staff, and the city administration was all for this thing. And I went there to view the process and work. But instead, I was shocked. As I reflect over it, I said maybe our failure to address all these issues. We've been so concerned with economic issues, you know. We've been concerned over at the Urban League, I know, with keeping the building open. We've seen all these programs that we've operated who were serving the poor beginning to go under, and so our primary thrust was there. And you look around, though, that some of our more fundamental things were beginning to, we know, were slipping away from us. So that I think, I don't want to sound rhetorical in this, but somebody says we've got to ever be vigilant in the protection of our rights. And I don't think that we've been that vigilant here in Peoria in these past 7-8 years.
Ernestine, do you think there's a possibility? I know this is very delicate, and I'm not I'm not famous for asking easy questions on CAPtions. But do you think it's possible also that the black community has become somewhat relaxed because we've elected our first black to the council and now we got somebody sitting there to take care of us and look out for the entire black community's interests and we needn't worry about what goes on Tuesday?
I think that even before we elected our first black council person, we had gotten very complacent. We did not speak out on issues, and I say we because I'd have to include myself in that. We got together and complained, but thought that complaint stayed amongst us. I think it's time we stopped doing that, which is why I stepped up to do that. I think it's time that we put that complacency aside and understand that racism is alive and well, that it's more blatant now than it was 5 years ago. We knew it was there 5 years ago, but it didn't rear its ugly head up. Now it's there. We need to start speaking out on issues. We need to quit getting into groups and discussing our problems and leaving it in that group. We need to start vocalizing that to our elected officials. We need to be attending a council meetings. We need to be attending the Fair Employment and Housing Commission meeting. When I worked for the city, we had the Fair Employment and Housing Commission that dealt with so many issues regarding the black community. Very, very few people ever attended those meetings. We need to be concerned. We need to start attending those meetings. We need to know what's going on.
Why will that committee, and I ask both you and Frank this, why is there an assumption that the Fair Employment and Housing Commissions can do a better job of handling discrimination than the mayor if he's going to appoint the committee?
I think what you have on that committee is some very good people that have their own opinions about things and that think for themselves. Of course, you know, you never know how that might change or evolve. That's why I say we need to watch that. We need to go to those meetings. We need to see what's going on. I think that if right now with that particular commission, you would get fair, just, honest opinions. And you're right, the mayor does appoint, but since I know those people, I know what would come out of them.
Yes, sir.
We always use the rationalization, well, it's an inconvenience for us to go to meetings, it's an inconvenience to do X, Y, and Z. But when you put it in the context, black folks have always been inconvenienced. And so what we need to do is start choosing the way in which we will be inconvenienced so that we will not allow the structure to dictate to us what has to be done. So I think we need to, and I agree with Ernestine and Frank, that we really need to become a little bit more active in choosing to go out of our way to do certain things, to look at certain situations, so that we can try to resolve them.
Our viewers, there's some of them sitting at home. They're saying, right on, man. You're absolutely right. And there may even be a few who are saying, how can I help? What can I do? I'm just one person. What can they do?
I think the first thing they can do is to call their city council person. You got to call the city council person and the mayor and express their outrage at the situation. And so that we can hopefully create a climate in Peoria where people can believe that acts of racial discrimination against black people are not going to be condoned. Certainly, the perception that we have that they're being condoned. And that's my perception of the situation right now.
Okay. That's one. I call my elected official. I don't know who mine is. What do I do?
You call City Hall and you ask for the city manager's office, and the person there will tell you who your elected official is.
So I call my elected official or I call City Hall?
Well, if you don't know who they are, you need to find out who they are. And if you don't know who they are by now, then that's a problem, because most of those people have been in office for a long time. But if you don't know, then you need to be checking City Hall, saying, "Who I'm in District 5, 4, whatever. Tell me who my council person is."
I got no use for politics and them people. As a matter of fact, my pastor said we don't get involved in politics. What do we do, Dr. Clark?
Okay. Well, I'm not quite sure at this point, but let me
You need to educate your pastor.
Let me offer a suggestion. There are a group of people who are going to get together to talk about strategies in order to deal with racism in the city of Peoria. We have traditionally been a group of people who've always reacted to the situation rather than trying to assess what the patterns have been and then being prepared to deal with those issues. If any person is interested in joining us, they could feel free to give me a call and I will set up the time and the place so that we can have an open and honest discussion about different strategies.
You got a number?
Yeah, 677-2426.
677-2426.
Yeah, and again, it's one of the problems we've had, I think, in Peoria is that we haven't really been creative enough or looked at a number of ways of dealing with discrimination. And I think it's time that we sort of have a brainstorming session just to get as many ideas on the table as possible. And then to present it, not everyone will agree that he or she can do certain things. But I have to believe that if you're going to select, if you're going to drink, as an example, you can choose a place to go to or not to go to. If you're going to go out to dinner, you can make that choice. Now, it might be an inconvenience because your other people friends want to go someplace, but then it's your responsibility to convince them. If you're having a banquet or bringing a group into town, you can make decisions that will affect the economic impact of what is going on. Okay. But we need to be aware of all of the variety of opportunities.
Surely. And summing it up, what I hear us saying is, one, we need to take a look at how we use our political influence and our votes and become informed on how to make good choices about elected leadership. And two, I hear us saying we also need to make good decisions about how we use our dollars and how we pick our friends and where we spend them. And those are two approaches that seem to be on the front burner in terms of discussion and organizing around the issue of impacting and diminishing racial discrimination in Peoria. I certainly appreciate a chance to chat with all of you. I see us having to wind down now in terms of bringing this to a close, but I think it would be important that for those of you in our viewing audience, that I extend an invitation to you to write us or give us a call here at CAPtions at 671-3905 if you have questions that you would like put, because what I think we need to follow this series with is an opportunity to talk to the elected officials and invite them on and hear from them where they stand on this issue and to hear some of the questions that you in the audience or maybe you, our guest tonight, have proposed. In closing, again, I want to thank you and wish you the best of luck. Certainly, I think we're going to need, more than that, we're going to need people's involvement and support, and you certainly have ours here, and we're going to get you back. Thanks a lot for taking time out of your schedules to come. For you and our viewing audience, I hope we've brought you a little closer to the issue of racial discrimination and the far-reaching implications of it. You may have been sitting home comfortably thinking, rumors, I don't drink, it has nothing to do with me, but it does affect you. With that, we're going to run. This has been Mike Banks. Good evening.